spoke of what scarcity is, what competition is, and then we looked at cost of production. That was the last bit we looked at.
Yeah.
So we ended off after entrepreneurship. So let's just double check.
And then I think I made more notes up to basic questions. Did we do that together?
Well, let's just keep going. Let's go back to the facts of production.
Because we did this exercise together and we didn't need to do this.
Let's go back to the facts of production and just have a look. Okay, that was the last on entrepreneurship. Okay, production and consumption, I don't remember us covering that. Okay, so let's go through that. Obviously, you've gone through it ahead of time.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Okay, so let me take the textbook then. That's great. So you've done a little bit of additional reading, which is always good. So let's focus on what's the most important bits and pieces we need to take out of each of these topics. Right, so last time we said factors of production are important. Why? What is its purpose? Like, why do we need factors of production? Okay, it's to meet needs and wants.
Yeah.
Okay, remember, chapter one, look at the heading. Basic economic ideas and resource allocation. That's important. So economic ideas are universal. Those things won't change. You'll see even later on in the textbook, they're probably going to talk about supply and demand in more detail, where you'll draw a graph. Okay, and that would be the point of equilibrium. Here, we're looking at the theory relating to economics and how we should allocate resources. Because what's the key concept in terms of resource allocation? Are the resources limited or unlimited?
Limited.
They're limited.
Yeah.
Correct. So, looking at the factors of production, that's going to create something that we can sell to our customers in the form of a good.
Mm-hmm.
So you get different forms of goods. You also get services. And we need those three with the expertise of the entrepreneur in order to create something of value so that we can create a product or a service that can satisfy needs and wants.
Yeah.
So the next bit in the textbook here is talking about production and consumption. So when you see the word production and consumption, what are you thinking about?
How much is produced compared to how much is actually used by the customer.
Okay, so if you're looking at production, who is responsible for the production?
The business.
Exactly. So production is internal because you decide on the amount of machinery that you have in the business. You decide on how much labor you have. You decide how many direct material you buy.
Yeah.
So production is relating to the supplier's ability to produce. And that's very important because later when we look at graphs, supply and demand, you'll see the supply graph slopes in a particular direction because suppliers are going to produce more goods based on its price. Okay, so ability to produce goods and services. Goods slash
services.
So
I'm going to carry on with this mind map and just make key.
Yes, that's good. Okay,
and
cool.
Then I'll make my detailed notes as part of my studying.
Yeah, you make very good notes. I'm not worried about that. I think
I'm just scared when I study from this, I don't study enough.
Yeah, well, it's just something different that I thought maybe you could try.
No, I'm going to do it.
The key points is the most important thing. So if you've got like a big topic, like the one that you wrote there, basic economic ideas and resource allocation, and then you've got just like the main like headings. Yeah, and then that helps. And then later on, you're obviously going to have a set of more detailed notes, and then those will go into like the detail. And that's great. So you can use them both. Yeah, because essays are difficult sometimes if you don't remember all the points.
Yeah.
So now the mind map can sort of help you remember all the points.
Yeah.
And then your extra notes can help you with the detail.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so here the textbook talks about production. Resources are combined in a process of production to create goods and services. We just spoke about that.
Yeah.
They also say capacity to satisfy wants. That's important. Okay, so there is going to be a capacity that we need to consider. Again, that relates to something later on.
Okay.
So we said consumption is important, okay, because that looks at the consumer, looks at the individual buying those goods that are being produced. So the second consideration here is consumption. And what does that relate to? Relates to the consumer, which is the customer. And if we just read the textbook in more detail, get a satisfying consumption in terms of needs and wants. Some goods and services, like chocolate, can be used up to satisfy our wants. Other things satisfy wants over a longer period. So you get immediate like satisfaction. So if I eat something nice, I get satisfaction in that moment. Okay, so the chocolate tastes nice. Okay, it's sweet, it's yummy and all of that. And then you get other things that satisfy wants over a longer period. And those are called durable goods, like television sets, refrigerators, and vehicles. So that's important to differentiate, because goods aren't just goods. You get different types of goods. So I'm just going to write here types of goods. And that we can see later. So you get durable goods, non-durable goods. A non-durable good would be like chocolates. A durable good would be a television set, okay, or a refrigerator. Right, then they've given you the two key terms which we just discussed, and they talk about unlimited wants. Okay, so unlimited wants refers to what? The production or the consumption?
Unlimited wants, production. Yeah.
No. Consumption. Okay, it relates to consumption because people are the ones who determine how much is going to be consumed. And maybe you can put your bracket C demand later. Okay, so when we talk about demand, it's looking at consumption, it's looking at those wants that consumers have. So here in the textbook, just to quickly summarize what they've given you here, they talk about food, shelter, and clothing. Those are necessities. Those aren't wants. Okay, those are needs. Needs are things that people have to have in terms of meeting their daily utility, survival. Yeah, that's probably a better way of looking at it. Okay, so things that we always need. Then you've got other things that we don't need, but that improves our quality of life. So wants tend to improve the quality of life. Right, so do we need a cell phone?
No.
No, but it improves the quality of life.
Yeah.
So now instead of having to travel and meet people face to face, we just pick up the phone and we call them. Okay, so that's wants. They also talk about luxuries, so you should know what those are.
Yeah.
Okay. And then they say consider the essentials for others. So some things people require and have to have, and certain things are luxuries that they don't. Right, just to have a look at the textbook here. Okay, they talk about preferences. That's also important when it comes to economics, because preferences change. Preferences will affect demand. See later.
About preferences in
business. Yes. Yeah, well, that was slightly different because there we were looking at the business in terms of its choice of what type of products and services they'll create. Here we're looking at it slightly different, because remember, how does economics differ from business studies? Let's just recap that. We spoke about it quite a bit.
Economics looks at the businesses industry.
Exactly. So economics is higher level,
yeah,
and it's like looking down at everything.
Yeah.
And then business studies is more like looking at the core, yeah, separate little things that you can do internally to help make a more successful business. Okay, so just to, let me just scan this and just see if there's anything else important here. You've already gone through this, so I don't want to read it again. I'm just checking what else is important here. Okay, they've given you some nice examples here. So instead of using their examples, here they talk about a family, they talk about a country, they talk about... What other examples here? Okay, here in terms of TV... So let's hear what example you've got in terms of an unlimited want. So wants, they say, grow when people change. Okay, for example, here they talk about getting married, raising a family, etc., and how the needs and wants change. So can you think of an example, something different?
Holiday.
Okay, so what about that relates to this? So explain it. Remember, in economics, you need to explain theory, back it up with what it is, and give an example. So always remember those three things.
Yeah.
Give theory, explain it, and give an example. Then you've covered yourself completely.
Yeah.
Okay, so
a holiday will be unlimited ones, but because it improves the standard of life, well, yeah, living, I
okay.
guess. And it's a luxury, it's an extra enjoyment, you don't need
Good.
To survive.
See, that's important.
Yeah.
See, you've covered that. So, what else? One more thing? Maybe an example?
Example, going to TikTok.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Or anywhere. It doesn't have to be local, it could be international.
Yeah.
So, that's a good example in terms of this. Unlimited wants. Okay, why? Because as you said, people always want to go to more places.
Yeah.
Okay, good. Right, then, next thing they talk about in the textbook here is choice and opportunity cost. I think we might even have discussed opportunity cost last time. Do you remember anything about
it?
Okay, so can you tell me what it is? Can you explain it to me? That's a very important one. You'll see it quite often in economics. I'm going to highlight it.
It's about giving up something for something else for
Good.
The best alternative.
Okay, so opportunity cost asterisks is they talk about foregoing something for something else. So in other words, you cannot have everything. So for example, could you be at home now watching a movie?
No.
No, because you can't do two things at once. You can't be at home and be here at the office.
Yeah.
Okay, so you need to decide where you want to be, then that's what opportunity cost is. So opportunity cost looks at what is foregone, okay, when choices are made. And that's what economists look at generally. They look at the effect. So if I choose to do one thing compared to another, what is that effect going to be on the broader economy? Okay, so remember, we're always looking at high level. So if the government, so what's happening next week? Actually, it's actually this week, it was last week. What happens this week?
Maybe the budget.
There we go.
Like the budget speech.
Yes, the budget speech. So the budget speech is going to be delivered, I think it's Thursday this week, and they're going to give the nation a breakdown on how the government is going to
spend
all the money that they've collected in the form of taxes. And that's very, very, very important for everyone to know because of... Yes, because of we obviously need to know, is the money being spent appropriately, and also opportunity cost. So now, the government needs to weigh up the pros and the cons. Is the budget limited?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so the government can't give an unlimited amount of resources to education, to build lots of schools. They can only give so much. The same thing with security and police and firemen and what else? Medical doctors and stuff like that. Right, they can also only allocate a certain amount. And that's what an opportunity cost is. So just to read the definition, the textbook describes it as opportunity cost, the cost expressed in terms of the best alternative that is foregone. Right, what does that mean? When you forego?
Choosing something, the better option, and giving up.
Exactly. Okay, so that's a good way of describing what they've just said there, is that if you choose one thing over the other, you're making a choice, and if you choose A, you can't have B. Right, so hopefully you've chosen the better option. That's always important. Right, just to, let me just scan the rest of the paragraph here. Okay, they talk about limited resources and unlimited once again. We've looked at a lot of that. Okay, opportunity cost, they've described how important that is, and then they look at an example. Okay, so here they've given you an example about choosing a gift voucher for your birthday or choosing to buy a DVD. Okay, buying a DVD. Actually, the gift voucher is what you get on your birthday, so that's not the choice. The choice is a DVD or a book. That's the opportunity cost. Right, so if I choose the DVD, can I buy the book?
No.
No, it's either one or the other. Okay, so the opportunity cost of choosing the DVD would be the book.
Yeah.
Okay, because the cost is what you give up. If I choose the book, then the opportunity cost of choosing the book would be giving up the DVD. Okay, it's always linked.
So the opportunity cost is the one you're giving up.
Yes, always. Yeah, because it's the cost. It's the cost that you're having to, how can I put it? Almost like inverted commas, take as a knock because you've made a choice.
Yeah.
Right, so another example could be, let's think about, what else? Okay, your favorite TV program. What do you like watching?
Gossip Girl.
Gossip Girl. Okay, so is there anything else that's on at the same time?
Yeah.
Probably.
Okay.
So if you're watching that one program, you can't watch the other as well.
Yeah.
Do you agree? So if you choose to watch that program, Gossip Girl, then you're not going to be able to watch another program. That might also be
so
on at the same time.
Opportunity cost would be that other program.
Correct. Opportunity cost is what you give up. It's always what you give up. So keyword here is foregone or forego. What you give up, what you forego. That's what it's all about. Okay, basic questions. What you produce, how, and for whom. Okay, this is looking at questions, economic questions to solve the problem. Because we spoke about the economic problem having limited resources, trying to satisfy unlimited needs and wants. Okay, so here number one says what to produce, how to produce, for whom to produce. That's looking at production. Who does that relate to?
The supplier and the
correct.
Manufacturer.
So let's add that. Asterisk. What? / how? / for whom? Question mark. Okay, that's production. Obviously, as a producer, as a supplier, I'm going to have to cover all three of those points when deciding on what to do. Okay, this I remember we did talk about, ceteris paribus. Okay, so let's write that down. Ceteris paribus. Okay, what does that mean? Any idea? Yes.
But I don't understand what it means.
Okay, we'll discuss it, what it means in detail. So, all else being equal. All else being equal. Right, and economists use this all the time. And why? It's because they need to cover themselves in terms of their responses or their observations. Okay, so last time, you were telling me about unemployment. So why did you say there is such a high level of unemployment in this country?
It's lack of education.
Okay, so lack of education. So now, if we look at ceteris paribus, that's saying that we're going to keep everything else equal.
Mm-hmm.
So if we're looking at unemployment, we're going to say all the other factors are going to be kept the same, and we're only going to look at one area, which is the level of education. Because remember, people could be unemployed for lots of different reasons. They might not be uneducated, they just might not have the opportunity, or they might have had a bad upbringing, or whatever the case is.
Yeah,
there's lots of factors. So, ceteris paribus is looking at, well, if we keep all the other factors constant, okay, how does education affect the unemployment rate in the country? That's what they're looking at.
So they're only looking at one point.
It's looking at one factor that changes, keeping everything else the same. That's what it's looking at. Okay, that's what ceteris paribus is. It's looking at making a statement about something, but you've got to keep everything else the same. So your statement still holds true. Because now, does your statement hold true if I say, well, the government actually wants to create free education for tertiary students.
Mm-hmm.
So let's assume that that is in place. Okay, it's not in place yet, it's still being discussed in government, but let's assume it is. So every single person that has finished matric would be allowed to study for free. See, that's my assumption.
Yeah.
Ceteris paribus would be, well, we're going to assume that everything else is the same. So we're going to assume that all the other factors that affect those students are constant, and we're only going to be looking at the one thing, which is education. So if we educate all those students, will they or won't they have jobs? That's the factor. So that's what you're looking at. It's looking at keeping...
They might still not have jobs.
Exactly. So that's why we're looking at the relationship between education and unemployment, because you can only look at two things that change. You can't look at more than one. If you look at more than one, then it becomes, they call it multivariate like observations or analysis.
All the reasons as to why someone...
Yeah, but then that becomes more sophisticated, because now you can't pull out specific reasons for certain factors.
Yeah.
Okay, it's like, let me try to think of like something that might apply, that you might have to do. Maybe like music. So in music, in terms of keeping everything else equal, so let's talk about, like, I don't know how familiar you are with the production side. So you're the singer, but like, how familiar are you with the production of the music?
I know the basics.
The basics.
Yeah.
Okay, so with the production, if we're looking at, like, creating the rhythm and, like, the back track when you're singing, so now, do they change everything, or do they change one thing at a time? They'll probably change one thing at a time, and then they'll listen to what happens.
Yeah, okay, this also needs to.
Exactly. So that's kind of what you're doing here, is that you're keeping everything else the same, and then you're, like, changing
one thing at a time.
Exactly, to see what the effect is. That's what you're trying to do. Okay, that makes sense. So, like, you might change the beat, you might change the tempo, you might change the bass. I'm not going to change all three in one go. I'm going to change each one. Okay, so I'll change one and then check ceteris paribus. Everything else stays the same. I'm just going to make the beat a bit faster or slower. Or I'm going to make the rhythm a bit different. I'm going to make the tempo better or worse or whatever the case is. Right, and that's kind of what you're looking at here. I don't know if that helps.
Yeah, that does.
Okay.
So if the government was looking to improve the unemployment rate and they chose this method, they would look at one factor at a time. So they would
first look at education. Yes.
And then if they've solved that, they've made education for free, then they look at the next thing.
Yeah, but remember, they're making a decision around education, assuming that everything else is the same. That's the big thing with economics.
Mm-hmm.
Is with economics, you can't guarantee that everything is going to be the same. In music, it's probably different because there you can guarantee it. So you can say, well, I'm going to definitely keep everything else the same because you control that. But in economics, you can't control the world. You can't control the environment, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
And that's why it's an assumption. Okay, it's something that the economists use to state that other things are going to stay the same.
Yeah.
That's all. Okay, and that's what they describe here. Alright, food versus fuel. I don't actually remember us discussing this.
We wrote it in my book.
Where's the book?
The pink book.
The pink book.
Yeah.
Okay. Alright, if you've done it already, that's fine, then we can just go through it next time and we can check it. Yeah, because this looks a little bit different. Here they've looked at a self-assessment task 2. Let's check your scope.
It just says we have to do 1.1 on page 16.
Let's have a look. This is week one.
Yeah.
Economic planning.
Yeah.
Key concepts. Task 3. Okay, do self-assessment task 1.1. Are we already there? It looks like we've progressed quite far then. Did we finish all of these other ones? Okay, great. Okay, so 1.6. That's 1.1. Okay, that's 1.1 on page 16. Sorry, wrong page. Okay. All right, so that's great. So we've covered that. Then we have to worry about it. Okay.
Maybe when we're done with economics, we can focus on business also on Monday.
Yes. Okay. Let's see. What's the next bit then? Okay, here is another example. This is 1.2. Do they want you to do 1.2? Doesn't look like it. Okay, yeah. Okay, so let's carry on with theory then. Okay, here they've just given you a bit of a note about the course again. Okay, you're obviously doing AS, and then A-level's slightly different. Okay, the margin, time, dimension. Okay, these are other economic ideas. I'm going to keep these separate. Let's put a heading here. Other economic ideas. Right, so these are related to economics, but they're not very, how can I say, in terms of, like, they're not ideas on their own.
Yeah.
They're supporting other things. Like, when you look at margin, margin is always used in relation to something else. Okay, so let's discuss the first one, margin. M-A-R-G-I-N. Okay, any idea what this means? Okay, this is new, right? We haven't covered this yet.
Yeah.
Okay, that's where you stopped. Okay, great. Okay. What do you remember?
I remember from accounting, we spoke about margin a little.
Okay, that's good. Yeah, so you're relating something here to something that you've covered before. So, from an accounting point of view, what is a gross profit margin?
It's the like margin where you make the amount you make.
Correct. So,
the
you make you make that profit on what? The cost.
On the cost.
Okay, so if I add a margin to my cost price,
it's your
Basically, yes. So like markup on cost, correct. Yeah. So the margin is what I'm going to get from the item that I'm going to sell. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, so the same thing applies in economics. I'm just checking what words do they use here for it. I would use the word the next. Okay, so that's just my own description of it. The next. The next something. It doesn't matter what it is. Here, they talked about many aspects of microeconomics involve analyzing decisions at the margin. See, at the margin. By this, we mean a small change in one economic variable. See, that's what they're looking at. So let's use what they've described. A small change in one.
So would this be a definition?
No, not really. I'm just trying to explain what margin is.
Okay,
it doesn't have a set definition. It's more a concept. That's the key. Okay, so one economic, a small change in one economic variable. That's what they've used to describe it in the textbook. Small change in one economic variable that'll lead to changes in another variable. That's all they've said. Okay, my way of describing it would be the next. Okay, because they talk about like marginal something. So I'm going to put a word here.
Would margin be like a period of time?
No. It's got nothing to do with time. Marginal. Okay, marginal is looking at like the next item. So we talked about this example. I can't remember what was it looking at though. We were talking about eating something. What do you like eating? I can't remember what it was. Was it, I think we were talking about, was it chocolate or, I can't remember. You don't remember? Okay, favorite chocolates?
Lindt.
Okay, so if you eat one slab of Lindt chocolate, are you going to enjoy eating that slab of Lindt chocolate?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, I give you another slab, and I tell you to eat the Lindt chocolate. Will you enjoy eating that chocolate?
Yeah.
Okay, now I give you a third slab. Will you eat it?
Yeah.
And the fourth slab?
Yeah.
And the fifth?
No, I'm joking. Yeah.
Okay.
No, I won't eat it anymore.
You won't eat the first slab?
No.
Okay, so you'll eat four
slabs.
I'll eat
the second slab.
Oh, you won't eat the second?
I'll just do it.
Okay, so with margin, you're looking at that. It's the next. So we're looking at the decision in terms of what you're going to be changing. The small change in economic variable that will lead to a change in another variable. So if I give you more and more chocolates, do you derive more or less satisfaction from eating those chocolates?
Yes.
Less, exactly. Because at some point it just gets too much.
Mm.
It's like then it becomes something undesirable rather than desirable in terms of chocolate. Because chocolate is nice, but you just can't eat too much of it. Right, and that's what you're trying to look at here in terms of margin. So margin, they often use margin or marginal. They use those two words to talk about this whole idea of the next. Okay, so the next chocolate, the next whatever. Okay. Time dimension. Here they're looking at short run and long run. That's pretty easy to understand. That's like economics. I know economics, that's like accounting.
So I've never used chocolate as an example, but how would margin... look at margin in terms of a business?
Well, this wouldn't be a business. The margin would be...
Well, economy. Like
yeah. So economics would be like... they talk about like marginal utility. Or they'll talk about marginal profit or marginal something. It's like... It's how much are you going to derive from the next item? So, for example, if I'm a producer...
Would it look at how much you... what word did you use? Deriving from a specific amount?
Okay, so here's an example. I'm a producer. Okay, we're manufacturing textbooks. Okay, the marginal cost of producing the next textbook would be what? Higher or lower?
The same.
No, it wouldn't be the same.
Higher. No,
possibly. Why?
Maybe because it's always improving.
Not so. Because think about it. If I make one textbook, can I make the textbook?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. If I'm making two textbooks, I can still make the textbook.
Mm-hmm.
What happens if I'm making 1,000 textbooks?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to need machinery. I'm going to need help. I'm going to need a lot of resources.
Yeah,
do you agree? So the marginal cost of manufacturing the next textbook could be more or less depending on the situation. Because sometimes if I produce more, mass production could be cheaper than manufacturing a single item. Okay, so I can't say for certain if this is better or worse than that. Okay, what I can say is, well, if I'm going to be looking at the cost of manufacturing this textbook, how much would it cost me to make the next textbook?
Yeah.
See, that's just one example of using the word margin. Okay, marginal costs. I could use the marginal utility story, then I would talk about eating chocolates.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, how much satisfaction or utility will you get from eating the next slab of chocolates? So the first slab, you'll say 100%. Okay, I'm going to be enjoying the first chocolate that I eat. Okay, the next chocolate, I'm going to say maybe 95%.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because now I'm not going to enjoy eating the second slab as much as the first. And that'll obviously diminish. They talk about diminishing utility. Because the more you get of something, the less you enjoy of it. Okay, that's an economic concept that will probably be discussed later. Okay, I'm just mentioning it now because you asked for an example. Okay. All right, so time here, just to carry on with this discussion, time dimension. Okay, so now you were talking about time. So earlier you asked about marginal relating to time. It doesn't relate to time. Time dimension does. They talk about short run versus long run. And it's very easy to remember. One refers to a short period, so short run. Here they describe it as a period of time which is possible to change only some inputs. Okay, so can I change my labor over the short term?
Yes.
Can I change my materials? Yes. Can I change the building? No, that's going to take a while.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's the difference between short run versus long run. It's looking at decision making in a particular area where changes can occur. Right, so we just spoke about one example. I can change everything about producing the product that I'm making. So I can change the color of the product. I can change, if I'm talking about a textbook, I can change the cover. I can change the size of the text. That's not going to take much time and effort. That's short run. If I want this paper to be glossier, I could print it on glossy paper. If I wanted it more matte, I could use matte. Okay, that's something short run. Long run would be, well, let's rewrite the textbook. Let's create a fourth edition. This is a third edition textbook.
Yeah.
Right, the fourth edition is a long run type decision. Because you're not going to be able to launch edition number 4 in the short term. That takes time. And that's what they're talking about here. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Alright, positive and normative statements in economics. This is just something that looks at the interpretation. So let's just write down the word normative and positive. Positive statements. Let's keep them separate and then normative. Normative statements. This is very detailed economics in terms of like theory and vocabulary. I doubt they'll ask you a question like this, what is normative, what is positive? It's probably not going to come up. But they'll probably give you statements that could be either or. Yeah. So, here they said it's useful to make a distinction between positive and normative. Economics in a social science is a social science. Okay, developed using analysis. That's key. Okay, so this relates to what? Analyzing. Yes. Analysis. Okay, so when we look at things, we can draw certain conclusions. Right, so a positive statement would be something like this. A fall in supply of petrol will lead to an increase in its price. Does that make sense? If the supply of petrol had to decrease, there will be an increase in its price.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, why do you agree with that?
Yes,
okay, because there's looking at one concept. So if I remove the amount of petrol in the market, it will automatically increase its price.
Yeah.
That's a positive statement. Another example. An increase in tourists in the Maldives will create more employment. Do you agree with that?
Yeah.
Why?
Because more labor will need to take place.
Exactly, yeah. So more tourists mean more opportunities. So the hotels are going to need to probably employ more people to look after those tourists. And then another example, an increase in tax will result in fewer goods being sold. Yes. Okay, if the government increases VAT, it's going to make prices more expensive. And if prices are more expensive, people buy less. Okay, not always the case though. So that's why I see it's ceteris paribus. If we keep everything else the same, we can make that assumption. Okay, so why do you think those three statements are positive? Any idea?
Because they're true.
Okay, that's something to look at, because yes, all three of those statements make economic sense. Right, so here they describe it as, the statements of what will happen based on empirical evidence are known as positive statements. What is empirical evidence? Okay, empirical means, imperial system. Okay, the imperial number system. You get different number systems. You get Roman numerals. Let me rather talk about this. Kilograms versus pounds. Which one do we use?
Kilograms.
Yes. Okay, we're a British colony, so we still use kilograms. We don't use the American system of measuring pounds, okay, in terms of weight. Here, they're saying statements that will happen based on evidence. Right, so how do you know that the price of petrol will increase when the supply is less?
Because
you've seen it before.
Yeah.
Okay, you've got empirical evidence that proves that it's going to happen. Right, so positive statements. Just to summarize this, you could say... conclusions that can be made ahead of time based on past observations / empirical or brackets empirical research evidence, not research, empirical, okay, evidence. Okay, so all of the statements you said were true, which is fine, which is correct, but it's true based on what?
Past observations.
Exactly, what we've seen in the past.
Which is known as empirical evidence.
Which is known as positive statements.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
the past observations is known as empirical evidence.
Yeah, well, the past observations is referring to the empirical evidence, yes. Okay, let's see what else we've got here. Okay, now they've talked about normative. Okay, so here's the examples. Number one, and should be beneficial for the environment. Okay, so here they said, if the supply of petrol leads to an increase in price, this is going to benefit the environment. Do you agree with that statement?
Yeah.
No.
Less people will buy.
But is that going to benefit the environment?
Yes, because it's no pollution.
Okay, you see, here's the big thing, it's the debate. Okay, so you're going with yes, it will benefit the environment. I can go with no. Why? Because let's think about this. Are businesses still going to have to transport their goods from place to place?
Yeah.
Yes. It doesn't matter what the price of petrol is, they're going to have to transport goods from A to B. Does that make sense? So even though you're increasing the price of petrol, it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to save the environment.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so normative statements leave an element of debate / subjectivity. Do you know what that means? What does subjective mean?
Being biased to...
Correct. Yes, being biased is the right way of describing it. Okay, so when you have normative statements, there's always an element of subjectivity or debate. Right, because now you can say what you said and you can be right. I can say what I said and I can also be right. Okay, it's a normative statement because it's based on subjectivity. Right, it isn't set in fact based on empirical evidence. See, so positive means empirical evidence, you can't debate it. Okay, I've got the facts. If you don't believe me, we can check the price of petrol when the supply decreases. You see what I'm saying? Okay,
yeah.
It's positive. Normative? Well, yes, I understand what you're saying, but I don't believe you. Okay.
Yeah.
Because there's a room for debates. Okay.
Depending on what subject.
Depending on your motivation.
Yeah.
Okay, so you could be right or you could be wrong. Doesn't matter. Both can be right. Depends on how you motivate. Okay, we're almost there. I'm going to ask you to carry on because you haven't looked at these things. The next few are quite short and they're quite nice. They're looking at other economic ideas. We've covered positive and normative. These are just statements when looking at analysis. Next two, specialization. Specialization. S-P-C-I-A. I-S-A-T-I-O-N. Okay. And exchange. Right, so your turn to do some reading and summarizing for us.
We're there. Specialization and exchange. One of the ways in which more goods and services can be produced in the economy is through the process of specialization. This refers to a solution where individuals and firms, regions and nations concentrate on producing some goods and services rather than others. This can be clearly illustrated at the individual level. Within the family, there may be some specialization in the performance of household tasks, with one person doing the ironing and gardening while another does the shopping and cooking. In the workplace, of course, the fact that some people and laborers or lorry drivers
yeah.
while others have office jobs is also a reflection of specialization. At this level, specialization allows individuals to concentrate upon what they are best at, meaning more goods and services will be produced. With specialization, however, although more is produced, no one is self-sufficient. It becomes necessary to exchange or trade goods and services. As an individual specializes, they will produce a surplus beyond their needs, which they can exchange for a surplus of others. With the expansion of trade and development of markets, the benefits of regional and national specialization become apparent. Surpluses produced by regions and countries were bought and sold, allowing world living standards to rise. Just as individuals concentrated on what they were best at, so did regions and countries.
Okay, so give me the crux. What are they talking about?
They're just speaking about different people have different skills, so they specialize in different things.
Why do we do that?
Because one person can't do everything.
Good. So what's the exchange side of things looking at? So you've told me what specialization deals with. That's fine.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me about the exchange side.
Okay.
The exchange side. So it's specialization and exchange.
Oh, okay. So the exchange comes part in when you need another resource or skill or service, but you aren't able to do that, so you exchange with another person in terms of service.
Good, and does that build the economy?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, so do we do everything?
No.
No. So, like, for example, do you cook your own food?
Sometimes.
Do you farm your own vegetables?
No.
Do you knit your own clothes? Do you clean your own garden? Okay, so some things we do, some things we don't. Why?
Because we don't have skills in the area.
Possibly, but
we don't have time.
It allows you to focus on what you're
good at.
And if you're doing something you're good at, can you produce more or less?
More.
Exactly. So specialization looks at producing, or let me use this, letting the inverted commas best people produce what they're best at. Okay, so do you agree farmers are good at farming?
Yeah.
So are we going to let them farm the vegetables? Yes. And then we'll just exchange what we're good at doing for fruit and vegetables from them. Does that make sense? Right. And that's what economics is all about. It's looking at trying to maximize the resources as much as possible. Because if we all had to farm our own fruit and vegetables, we're not going to be able to do anything else other than farming our own fruit and vegetables. It wouldn't be very productive. Right? Then we wouldn't have other things. Right? Then we couldn't manufacture other goods or services.
Yeah.
Okay. And then the exchange is what happens when you have an excess of goods. Right, so excess of supply leads to an exchange. Okay, it's like bartering. Okay, you give me fruit, I'll give you vegetables. You give me fruit, I'll give you something else, water, okay, or clothing, or stationery, or something else, okay, technology. Doesn't matter what. Okay, but that's what the exchange is focusing on. Okay, that pretty much covers those ideas. Now the textbook is changing a little bit because they're looking at factors of production in more detail. Okay, so again, I'm just going to keep this as other, just not to change the headings too much. Other economic ideas. Now they're talking about the division of labor. Next topic. Okay, so before we read it, tell me what you think about labor in terms of division of labor. What do you think it's going to focus on?
What is my division of labor? This is also like skills of where you fit best in the business.
Good. Okay, it's definitely looking at skills relating to people because labor refers to the people skills, okay, or the people aspect of the business. Okay, so quickly read that little bit there. With the technical advance of the last few hundred years.
With the technical advance of the last few hundred years, production of goods and services has taken place on a much bigger scale. The concentration of large numbers of workers within very large production units allowed the process of production to be broken down into a series of tasks. This is called the division of labor. For example, Adam Smith, writing at the end of the 8th century, showed how the production of pins would benefit the application of division of labor in a factory. He suggested that pin making could be divided into 8 industry operations, and that if each employee undertook only one of the operations, production would rise to 5,000 pins per employee per day.
Okay, so what does that speak to?
Division of labor, where manufacturing process is split into a sequence of individual tasks.
Okay, and why?
To produce more.
Exactly, to create more output. So here they're looking at labor. So let's talk about making the textbook. Let's keep that focus. Okay, so if this textbook had to be produced, what do you think goes into making a textbook like this?
Labor.
Okay, but what labor? Be more specific, because we're talking about division of labor. Okay, that's important. So now you're talking about the author. Right, so if you look at the front page, good, that's publishing. Right, so when you look at this, here you'll see all the different, let's say, acknowledgements that the textbook has done in terms of author and publisher. Okay, because you said we need to bind the textbook, we need to print the textbook. That's the publisher's job. Maybe we need to market and advertise the textbook, also something different. Then we need someone to sit down and write this textbook. Yes, distribution, good. So, division of labor looks at, let's use the word they used here.
Splitting. And you get more big paper.
Okay.
More papers finished now.
Okay.
I'm just going to run to the bottom.
No problem.
Okay.
No problem. Okay, so we were just describing what this is. Division of labor, splitting the manufacturing process into different areas in order to produce or in order to increase output. Okay, that's why you're looking at division of labor. It's another form of inverted commas. It's almost like specialization. Because you're giving someone who's the best at doing something the task. Okay. Right, remember, how many pages do we need to get you for economics? 128 pages,
okay.
That's it. And we're already on page 19. So we've almost finished 1/6 of the content. Okay, so economics I think we'll be fine with. As long as you're comfortable with the theory. The theory is so important. There's actually something that I want to send to you. So what I also want to try to do to help you stay on track is like after today, like after each lesson, I'm just going to send like a quick note just to say, well, okay, we've covered this. Please look at these questions and then we can check next week. You know, just to keep everything okay. Yeah, you've already got, yeah, you did some of it, you said, so that was fine. So we'll just review and check and see how you went about it. Okay, with the explanation, that's key. Okay, so next page. That was just a short bit there. The top here, I was looking at it while you were taking a little break here. Just over here, it's giving you examples. Okay, so what can we do? So I don't want you to use their example in the textbook. Let's rather come up with your own example.
Of division of labor.
Yes.
Okay, we can use the example of my mom's law firm.
Okay, perfect.
Certain people do certain things. There's a receptionist.
Good.
She has the skills to answer the phone,
send
out emails. There's an attorney.
Good.
That goes to court for my mom.
Good.
There's a conveyancer that handles the banks.
Yes.
There's different people that do different things.
And why?
To run the production down.
And do you agree, everybody can work at the same time?
Yeah.
Right? Good. Okay, so that's the key.
And to get all the tasks done in one day.
Exactly. Okay, it's a good example. Right, so just remember, it's just a way to speed up or to increase output. Right, because if one person had to do everything, it would be very difficult.
Yeah.
It's possible, but it would just take a lot more time and effort.
But
exactly, it takes more time and effort, and it wouldn't be as productive then. Right, so I'm looking at the textbook here, obviously, as we go, not textbook, what is this called? The program, yeah. Just to see if we're on track, because I see that they tend to focus on certain things more than others. Like, in the textbook, they don't even mention this, division of labor.
Okay.
Okay, so I don't think it's that important, but at least we've covered it, because we do need to cover 128. Alright, so, doesn't seem that important here. The next bit is important, though. Systems of resource allocation. Here they talked about economic transformation, economic structure, which is building onto the next bit, which is the mechanisms. So that's important. Here they've given you quite a bit of notes in the program. All right, so let's put a bit of a heading for this then. Resource allocation in different economic systems and issues of transition. So I'm going to use the word economic systems. Economic systems.
What are the two benefits that you used?
What benefits?
For division of labor, we said.
Division of labor, increased
tasks,
productivity.
Yeah. Increased outputs and all tasks to be completed.
Yeah, so more efficiency. So efficiency would be able, in terms of capacity. So to be efficient means we can do a lot with a little bit amount of time. Okay, so. I'm sure even you see it. Some workers, maybe even here at your mom's business, that some workers are very productive.
Yeah.
And others take a little bit more time to do the job.
Yeah.
But the jobs still get done,
yeah.
But
in
it just depends on efficiency.
Yeah.
And then the other thing would be like output. Okay, but like output, when I say output, I mean not output for one person, but output for like the business. Yeah, so that would be productivity. Yeah, so more efficiency, that's the one, and then more productivity. Because efficiency is looking at how do you do things.
Yeah.
Okay, it's like you're studying. Your studying is very efficient. Why? Because you make notes as you go through the theory. So it's not like we're reading the theory, then we go back and we make notes. See, that's inefficient.
Yeah.
Okay, efficient is time saving, exactly. Doing more in a specific amount of time. Productivity is having outputs. So how much do I actually land up with at the end of the day?
Yeah.
Alright, next bit. Don't worry about that. That was an example. You gave me one. Start there.
Okay.
Economic structure.
Okay. The term economic structure refers to the way in which an economy consists of various sectors. It is used to show the balance of economic activity. usually measured in terms of value of total output between these sectors. The following sectors are recognized. As you said, the definition they gave us, the way in which an economy is organized in terms of sectors.
So measuring, I wouldn't say measuring, it's more classifying.
Is this
organizing.
A different idea now?
No, not a different idea. It's still looking at this, basic economic ideas,
okay.
But now we're not focusing on labor, we're not focusing on scarcity, we're focusing on economic systems. So what system is used within a economy? So in a functioning economy where you have suppliers and consumers, what are we actually going to be producing? And with that production, what are we, or how are we organizing it in terms of sectors? So measuring slash organizing, what can I use? Let's use the word sectors, I guess. Sectors, measuring slash organizing sectors, that's good enough. Okay, then they've given them to you, primary, secondary, tertiary. We've actually looked at this before.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember what primary focuses on without looking at this? Try. Fine.
The way with extracting raw materials.
Good. Example?
Farming.
Secondary?
Using primary sector resources, such as raw materials.
To do what?
Adding value, producing the good.
Good. Example?
Clothes, making clothes.
Okay, good. So we take the wool and the cotton, we make clothing. Good. Third, tertiary?
Providing the service to the clients.
Yeah, that's different.
Clients, so selling.
Yeah, that's good. Well done. Okay, so that's looking at the service sector. So it's very easy. We've covered it before, so I'm not going to write down too much because we've got it on a separate slide. I'm just going to write down recap, primary, slash secondary, slash tertiary. Okay, and then you just refer back to your note, which you've already looked at, and you've covered it well, so you're familiar with what those different areas are. Okay, so no need to go into too much detail because you already know it. There is another, though.
What do they mean by the way in which an economy, which economy are they talking about?
Economy is broad, hey? It's like
okay.
Everybody, every single person, every single business, every single organization, government, public, private, you name it. The person on the street, the person in the office.
The economic structure of South Africa.
Not South Africa,
or
broad, like world. Because remember, you get the world economy, then you get this African economy, then you get like the Gauteng economy. Then you could talk about like the Johannesburg economy. So economy is just looking at that like mixture between buyers and sellers operating in the markets.
Okay.
That's all.
What did you say? Sorry, say it again, please.
An economy is just looking at like buyers and sellers operating in the market. Because you get the world economy, you get the local economy, you get the South African economy, you get the Joburg economy. So economy is just broad. It's a loose term. It's a loose term looking at buyers and sellers, consumers and suppliers. That's it.
So if we're looking at the South African economy,
it would
economic
just
structure would mean how the South African economy is split.
Is organized. Exactly. There you go. You got it.
Okay.
Okay.
I just get confused with the term economy. Like
yeah,
it's
a very loose term, so you can use it however you like. I mean, you can talk about the economy as being the JSE or
mm-hmm.
the
Could you talk about the
GDP.
Economy of law in South Africa? The law.
Ooh, okay, that's a bit of a stretch.
Like only looking at law businesses.
No. So that's a bit different because now you're talking about law. Law would be what sector in the economy?
Tertiary.
Exactly.
Okay,
so if you're talking about law, you're talking about the tertiary sector in the South African economy.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, that makes sense.
Okay. Right, there is another. How do you say that? Quaternary. Okay, so it's not tertiary. That's the next one. Yeah, quaternary or whatever. Okay, it's quite a fancy word to describe the fourth. Right, but the fourth sector is what? Read it. It's interesting.
A relatively new term to denote the knowledge based part of the economy, especially the provision of information. Typical examples are scientific research and product development, computing and ICT.
Good. Okay. First time I see them actually pointed out, like pointing out this specific area. Okay. It like if you look at older textbooks, you won't see it. Why? The world has changed a lot. This textbook was published when? Let's have a look. 2015. That's a very, very new in terms of like textbook where they're covering like relevant information. Right. Older textbooks don't talk about a fourth economy. Or not economy. Fourth sector of the economy. Obviously, things have changed. So I'm going to write it in here. New sector equals, let's use that fancy word, Q-U-A-T-E-R-N. A-R-Y. Okay, in brackets, what are they looking at there? Knowledge based. Alright, so that's looking at like internet businesses, what else? Transmitting information, communications, that type of thing. So more ICT, let's use that. Knowledge based ICT. And they've used the word ICT there as well. I don't think they'll test you on the 4th. That's very new. Unless they are something relevant to what's happening now, it wouldn't really be something that would be applicable. Okay. Point bullet is.
So sorry, an example of this was science as research.
It could be science. It could be
research division.
Technology. It could be internet. It could be anything cutting edge. So not part of the primary, secondary, or tertiary. So things have even gone one step further. So remember, tertiary is what? Services. So banking is a service. Do you agree? But now, online banking could be something that could be viewed as like the next sector.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's something, it's like taking that service further beyond what banking is. Because banking in the past just used to be people. Okay, do you want a loan? Yes, I do. Okay, the bank will give you the loan, you have to pay the bank back. It's just the service, that's tertiary. But now, they've just taken that one step further where they've looked at this whole idea of ICT and knowledge and information.
What does ICT mean?
ICT is technology. It's the, I think it's international communications and technology. No, not international, information. Information, communication and technology. Yeah, it's information, communications and technology. It's looking at like Facebook, Twitter, those type of things. Like modern technology-based businesses. Because now the world has changed. And it will continue to change. Maybe one day in the future we'll even have a fifth sector, which we don't know what it exists or what it is currently.
Yeah.
But it could be something in the future.
Okay.
Okay, keep going. Resource allocation. Okay, they've given you quite a bit here in terms of the actual allocation of resources. So remember, resources are what? Limited. So here we're looking at the allocation of limited resources. So what does that involve? Let's have a look.
Okay, system of resource allocation. The problem of scarcity, which in turn requires choice to be made, is one that is common to all economies, rich and poor. The choices that are made and which can realistically be made are determined by the economic system of a particular country.
Yeah.
This term is used to describe the means or allocative mechanism by which its people, business, and government make choices. Traditionally, economists have recognized three distinct types of economic system. These are the market economy, command or planned economy,
good,
and the mixed economy. Let us briefly consider each in turn.
Okay, this is very important. The work program actually highlights it as well.
Okay.
So this is an NB1. Okay, so A, market economy. B, command economy. which is the last one, mixed economy.
Yeah.
I think we might even have talked about these before as well, but not in so much detail. Here, they're describing it in a lot of detail because this is looking at the resource allocation according to a specific form of economic system.
Yeah.
Okay, and different systems have different ways of doing it. Okay. Alright, so
resource allocation.
Yeah, that's the focus, resource allocation.
So market economy.
Yeah, the first one.
What?
Market economy. Let's read what they've described.
So economic system, this the means
Yeah, those are just definitions for each of those things. So an economic system is just that economy. That's how
so
the economy is structured. Yes, you can start doing.
In a market economy, decisions on how resources are to be located are usually taken by millions of households and thousands of firms. The exact number will, of course, depend on the size of the economy. The key point is that the interact of as buyers and sellers in the market for the goods and services. The key point is that they interact as buyers and sellers in the market for goods and services. Prices and the operations of the prices system underpin the interaction. Prices act to indicate the likely market value of particular resources. For example, a commodity in short supply, but that has a high demand attached to it will have a high price. Alternatively, one that has a high supply and low demand will have a much lower price attached to it. Prices and the self-interest of people and businesses therefore act as a guide to the decisions that have to be taken. Economics as a subject has its origin in the notion that prices and the market mechanisms are the best way of handling economic problems. This notation can be particularly be particularly attributed to the Scottish economist Adam Smith, who is remembered for his reference to an invisible hand, the price system, that brings together private and social interests in a harmonious way. This is the fundamental philosophy underpinning the workings of a market economy. The government has a very restricted part to play in a market economy. For example, in Smith's view, it should control national defense acts against monopolies, issue money.
What is a monopoly? Do you know?
No, it's not a game.
Okay, so the game is not quite the true sense in terms of monopoly, but it kind of is, because what's the objective of the game monopoly?
The buying and selling of the markets.
Yes, and how many players? Okay, well, there could be lots of different players, doesn't matter, but what's the goal? Like, who's the winner of the game? The person that owns everything, or the most. So monopoly is looking at having a very big portion of the market, which gives you an unfair advantage. Because, like, in the game Monopoly, it's often the people that own the most properties, those are the ones that tend to win. Why? Because they have all those spaces. So if you land this on their block, then you've got to pay them something. So that concept is similar to what they're talking about here in terms of Monopoly. So Monopoly could be, let's think of, Eskom. Would you say Eskom's a monopoly?
Mm-hmm.
Why?
Because they buy parts of the market.
Not quite. What does Eskom do? Produce?
Electricity.
Exactly. Does anyone else do that?
No.
Not at the same scale as Eskom.
Mm-hmm.
You get very small businesses that look at producing electricity. That could be like maybe solar power or wind or battery or something like that, or generators, but it's not like producing power for the entire country, because there's only one Eskom. Okay, that's a monopoly. A monopoly is when you have one or very few players in the market. Okay, there's not a lot of competition, and that's bad. Okay, businesses want monopolies, but consumers don't. Because as a consumer, if there's a monopoly, the supplier sets the price. And you don't really influence that, because there's only one person to buy from. Okay, all right, keep going.
The government has a very restrictive part to play in the market economy. For example, in Smith's view, it should control national defense, act against monopolies, issue money, raise taxes, and so on, while protecting the rights of private sector. It certainly should not to influence the dealings of individuals in the market or to regulate the workings of that market. It's a simple representation of these functions. Before moving on, it must be made clear that the market economy is an ideal that does not exist in today's complex globalized economy. Arguably, its most important representation is the United States of America, and it should be stressed that here, federal and state government play important roles in the economy and society, as well as in providing defense, law and order, and other public services. Hong Kong provides an interesting case of what at one time was a near perfect example of a market economy. Virtually all businesses are privately owned. Its public transport services, the road tunnels, are similarly operated by private companies. There is, however, rather more regulations that is being introduced to control aspects of the operation since the 1997 handover to China.
Okay, so key points or points? If you had to describe the market economy in like two sentences, what would you say?
Who does it involve? It has to do with the buyers and sellers of the market.
Good. Only. So buyers and sellers make up the market. Okay, that's pretty easy to remember. So try and make your studying simple as well. Market economy, when you see the word market, immediately think about
the
buyers and sellers, exactly.
Yeah, as a definition they said, one where most decisions are taken through market forces.
Yes. Does the government affect the decisions in the market economy?
No.
No, because it's market driven. So this, they talk about being like perfect, ideal. So I wrote here, ideal system, it's a free market. Free market meaning no government or limited government influence. Right, there's something else that was important there. If you do study economics in more detail, they would actually require you to go in and research this invisible hand story. So just to give you the short like summary of it, the invisible hand means that the market is moved with invisible hands. So the forces in the market determine what happens in the market. So one particular product might be very popular, but now how do you determine how can you uncover what's determining that demand for that product? You can't. It could be lots of different factors. It could be marketing, it could be word of mouth, it could be preference, it could be maybe with the weather. So depending on the weather, depending on all these factors, this one specific product might just sell a lot compared to another. So here they're talking about the invisible hand, because the invisible hand is the market in terms of the market basically moves itself in terms of trends, in terms of preferences, in terms of products and services. So it's very difficult to control a market when the suppliers and the buyers are the ones that make up the market.
Yeah.
Because they're so different, they're diverse. I mean, you could have millions or billions of buyers and sellers for a specific product or service. And the invisible hand refers to the inverted commas stuff that you can't see that affects that market. So it could be something like laws. Do you think laws and rules will affect markets?
Yeah.
Yes. So if the government imposes a new tax on a specific good, like sugar tax, if you buy like cold drink now, appetizer, Coca-Cola, all those different brands, you actually now have to pay slightly more for those beverages because of sugar tax. Okay, and I think next week when they talk about the budget, they'll probably mention it again. It's really in effect. It came. The government spoke about that two budgets ago, and then it was actually implemented not so long ago. So going forward, in terms of the invisible hand, the market will basically sort of like move itself. That's like the very creative side of economics. You can't really put a finger on what is exactly happening in the market, but you can draw conclusions on what you think is happening in the market based on your analysis.
Yeah.
And ceteris paribus, so keeping everything else the same, because everything is invisible. Okay, there's things that we don't even know that's happening out there, and we don't know until we see the actual, let's say, results in the market. Okay, so maybe, I can't think of a product now. Can you think of one? A product that was very popular in the past that has died out now?
Blackberry.
Okay, that's a good example, actually.
Because it was the whole BBM.
Exactly. See,
now I'll use the BBM.
There you go. So now the invisible hand would affect that market. So the factors at that point in time drove that market. So at one point in time, BBM was like everything.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody had to have it, everybody was using it.
Mm-hmm.
And now, no one even uses it, no one even has it, because other things have replaced it. So the market changes. And that's why they talk about something like supply, buyers and sellers, free markets. Okay, it's free market because the market decides.
Mm-hmm.
No one decides. It's you and I and everyone else in the world that's a buyer or a seller that determines where the market goes. And that's very fascinating. And that's why they said it's an ideal world or an ideal situation, because it's never perfect. Even in today's world, you can't have a perfect market economy, because there's always some form of influence, be it government, be it other, that's going to affect the economy. Okay. Do you understand what that deals with? Okay.
So if I'm just going to write ideal system for market. Then
yeah, try explain it in a way that you would be able to, in terms
so can
of.
Can I say the buyers and market, the buyers and sellers within the market?
Yes. Doing what?
With no government influences.
With no or very little. You can, sometimes government will affect, but very little. Yeah. So you can definitely mention that buyers and sellers, with little or no government influence. Transacting freely. That's probably the best way to describe it. It's a free market economy. And if you want to, you can just put the word asterisk, invisible hand. Yeah, I doubt
so
you'll have to look at that in more detail.
Is the take over of you taking on to your article?
No, the invisible hand is the market in terms of things that we don't see that happen in the market that affects how things change going forward.
Mm-hmm.
So like you said BBM, so the invisible hand would have been when Android, when Google created Android, and then smartphones started using Android and that became more open source, and then you had Apple creating iOS, which was a more restricted system that can only be used on Apple products. So then that would be like invisible hand, because now preferences change. Before, BBM was like cool. Now BBM is like, no one even talks about it.
Now
it's WhatsApp.
It
could be anything, yeah. It could be WhatsApp could be taken over by a different system going forward. But you see, that's the invisible hand. So the invisible hand,
the unknown,
exactly. It's unknown factors and influences that affect a particular market. And no one knows what they are until you look back. Like now we can look back and say, well, Android and Apple killed BBM.
Yeah.
We can look back and we can say that.
Yeah.
But during that point, it was invisible because no one knew what was actually happening in the market. Until the market, like, that's why it's invisible.
Until a year after using WhatsApp, I realized, oh, what happened to BBM?
Yes, yeah. So the invisible hand is just how things gradually change over time. And no one knows what that is. But the market is the market is the market. Because the key thing is the market changes the way things are or will be. That's probably the biggest thing. like this higher level like consideration, if that makes sense.
Yeah,
it's not something that you can explain in like one keyword. That's why that guy, that economist, what is it? Adam somebody, right?
Adam Smith.
Yeah, Adam Smith. The guy that did the invisible hand.
Yeah.
He would have researched and developed the theory around this concept.
Yeah.
Looking and taking lots of things into consideration. Exactly. It's just an idea, and then when enough people do enough research on an idea, it becomes theory. Okay, and that's why it becomes part of the textbook, it becomes part of knowledge and information going forward. Yeah, I like economics because it's very like it's a thinking subject, but it's very creative as well. And that's why I like it, because it's not boring.
And that's why I think if you have the knowledge of business and background, you know what it's all about.
Yes.
You can apply it. I know it's not the same thing and you don't like
business is very good. That's why
by doing both,
I
understand
it's good. Yeah.
So now this is like another section onto the higher level thinking about.
Yeah, exactly. It's like a
looking
separate subsection. Yeah, that sort of like matches nicely with the other side. Yeah. It's a nice complementary subject.
Invisible hand, the unknown takeover of an improved development.
It's not really taking over anything, it's just the changing of. So it's like the adaptation. So the invisible hand is how the market adapts and changes. That's probably the main thing. Invisible hand is, it relates to the market, how it changes, how it adapts, how it develops, how it improves. Okay, no one person, no one company will change the market. They can influence, but the market's the market.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's just, it's its own like being, if you will. Okay. Next, command economy. Have you ever seen that word? Sovereignty. Yeah, sovereignty relates to...
Sovereignty,
which is what they're referring to there, is looking at the state, the government. So sovereignty is related to government, or like centralization, where you have like the boss that dictates everything. It's almost like a dictatorship, if you will.
Yeah.
Where you have someone or something like the government dictating how everything must be run, and you cannot argue and question the government. So that was like Germany back in the World War time, and then you've got more recent would be like Russia, also China as well. They also have a very like dictatorship type of rule where the government says what you do and you just got to do it. Yeah. So Russia is very similar, China in some extent, and then old Germany during like Hitler and during those times, where you have like a monarch. Okay, a monarch is the person who dictates how the citizens, how the businesses, how everything must run. And that's what they look at here. So, see, easy to remember. Pick out keywords. Command means control. That's what it's about. So, someone is telling you exactly what you must do in all instances. In business, in terms of production, in terms of supply and demand, all areas.
Yeah.
Okay, keep going. Sovereignty at the top.
Influences resource allocation. Whereas in a command economy, it is central planners who determine the collective preferences of consumer and manufacturing enterprise. The planned economies of the past 50 years also have their economic logic in the
Where?
I think it's
Marxism.
Sorry, I've never heard of these words.
Yeah, because this is economics based on like Adam Smith. So Adam Smith did The Invisible Hand.
Mm-hmm.
And The Invisible Hand is looking at the market driving the market, which is capitalist.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you've probably heard of capitalism and communism,
yeah.
Have you?
Communism, yeah, in history.
Okay, so what's the difference between capitalism and communism?
Communism is a takeover of a religion or...
No, it's looking at markets.
Oh,
it's got nothing to do with religion.
Communists,
yeah. So you get communists and you get capitalists.
Yeah.
So what's the difference? Okay. Okay, so capitalism is where you have an individual who's driven by sales and money in terms of capitalism. So capitalism is not for community. Okay, capitalism is, so the best example of a capitalist society is America. America is capitalist, why? Because if you work hard and you get rewarded, you deserve the reward. No, you shouldn't have to share it with anyone else. If you choose to, then that's up to you, because it's your choice. But what you do is for yourself, and that's capitalism. So capitalism is what we do in that society is for the benefit of the individual or for the benefit of the company. That's capitalism. Then you get the opposite, which is communism, and that's Marxism.
Mm-hmm.
So Marxism, so Karl Marx was one of the old economists that did research and all this stuff, and then Marxism is looking at communism. And that's like how businesses like Russia and China and in the past Germany were run in terms of like, it's for the people in terms of communism. So communism is now that it doesn't matter if you're a doctor or if you're a street sweeper, okay? Everybody is contributing to the society, so you all get paid the same.
Yeah.
Okay, that's how communism works. Capitalism is, well, if you're a doctor, you've got better skills than someone who's a cashier, so you as the doctor should be rewarded more because that's the capitalist nature of that economy. So capitalism is when you have like a reward-based system.
Yeah.
So doctors, lawyers, accountants, whatever, those people are higher level in terms of skills, they should be rewarded more. And then people with lower level skills shouldn't. Then you get the opposite, which is communism. Communism, everybody benefits the same. Why? It's because without the doctors, you're not going to have healthcare. Without the cleaners, you're going to have a very dirty society. So both are equally important for a functioning society. That's why communism is looking at the collective. So the government pays everybody like a blanket rate. So like a good example is, have you been watching any of the Winter Olympics?
Maybe? No, I'm not really into the sports.
Okay.
Not
into, okay, but but you've probably seen it on TV,
yeah,
maybe.
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, so
I like the swimming Olympics.
Yeah, that Summer Olympics, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So the Winter Olympics are currently being hosted in South Korea. So South Korea is democratized. Okay, so it's a democracy, and they're more capitalist. So following the traditions of America. And then you've got Northern Korea, North Korea, which is in the north, and North Korea is communist because they've got a dictator, literally, that tells how, that sets the rules of the government, literally states how everybody should run. They even dictate the type of haircuts you can have.
Sure.
All right, that's how strict it is. Like,
yeah.
I think there's
that,
like...
That's what I was thinking,
yeah.
Communism, the rules and the... That's what I had in my head.
That's correct, yeah. So that's communism. So communism is very, very strict, and the government runs everything. That's why I'm trying to use that here, because the word is command. Okay, so command economy, just think about governments controlling everything. It's like this African government telling you what you eat, how much you get paid, what you do, where you live, all of that stuff.
Yeah.
It's very strict. It's government control. Again, it's theoretical, because in today's society, even places like Russia and North Korea and China, those countries, yes, they might follow more communist type rule, but they're still very, also a little bit capitalist. So you never have completely free market economy, and you never have completely command economy. There's always like an in-between.
Mm-hmm.
And countries are either leaning towards the one or leaning towards the other. So South Korea would be leaning towards the free market. North Korea would be leaning towards the command. Russia would be leaning towards the command. South Africa would be leaning towards the capitalist. So it just depends. There's no best or worst case scenario. Both have their pros and cons.
Yeah. Okay. Sorry.
Yes, that what that means. You can write if you want to, or do you want to finish reading? Because you stopped. Yeah, you stopped at Marxism. So Marxism is just the guy that did research around communism, basically.
Okay.
Just to keep this the backstory short.
Yeah. So Marxism criticism of the market economy. The particular objection was essentially one of the class conflict between the wealthy owners of capital and the poor working classes who provided this wealth through the production process.
See, the debate between rich and poor.
Yeah.
Okay, because now in a communist society, you also get rich and poor, but it's leveled out.
Mm-hmm.
Doctors are the same as cleaners. Doctors are the same as cashiers. They level everything out. That's what they do in that society. In the other side, they promote inequality in a way, okay, because it's a different system, that's all.
Okay.
There's pros and cons to both.
Okay.
The best is number three, mixed economy, which we haven't got to yet. Yeah, we'll just finish this today and then
okay.
We'll call
yeah,
it
I was looking, these chapters are long.
Yeah, well, it's 128 pages.
But it's a long
the first
idea.
Chapter is
yeah.
long because of all the different
basic.
Ideas, basic ideas, correct? Okay.
Keep
going, almost done.
So the planned economies of the past 50 years also have their economic logic in the... Oh, sorry, I read that. Okay. The particular objection was essentially one of the class conflict between the wealthy owners of capital and the poor working classes who provided this wealth through the production process. Marx was also critical of the built-in unemployment arising out of the market system. For example, he had observed the trend to replace labor with machines and the inability of labor to secure higher wages. Under a planned economy, unemployment is not an issue. Marx was also very concerned about the way in which the market economy fostered the concentration of productive resources in the hands of large monopolistic industrial and commercial organizations. As such, he maintained the commercial organizations. That they corrupted the workings of the market and, if powerful enough, could exert pressure on the governments. Retrospectively, and in the light of empirical experience, economists have, with some justification, concluded that nevertheless, his general recommendation that more centralization should occur and that more emphasis should be placed on economic planning was being applied by those countries that have preserved the notion of a planned economy. So the key features of planned economy are that central government and its constitutional organizations take responsibility of allocations of resources, the determination of production targets for all sectors of the economy, the distribution of income and wages, the ownership of productive resources, resource property, planning long-term growth of the economy. From a practical standpoint, some of these decisions have been to decentralize either geographically or by sector to other government organizations. In central cases, these bodies have control over the working of a limited market mechanism. A good example of this is where basic foodstuffs such as bread and meat are heavily subsidized to keep prices at a fixed level and so spare consumers from the price fluctuations that are so commonplace in the market economy. Artificially low prices result in excess demand relative to supply. Queuing becomes a way of life. Although from a practical is very difficult for all enterprise to be state-owned. There has to be a limited opportunity for the private ownership of small businesses such as shops, restaurants, and personal services like hairdressing and cleaning. For more substantive business ownerships is often one on a shared basis between the state and the private sector. This often involves foreign investors who are keen to exploit the opportunities of an emerging market economy.
A lot of theory about this whole idea of command. So people in leadership are the ones determining what people do, where resources are allocated, etc. That's what they're trying to describe in all of this.
The outcome of the planned economy is that central planning tends to set goals for the economy that differ from those of the market economy. In particular, they have a clear objective of achieving as high a rate of economic growth as possible. In order to catch up on the process being made by much more advanced market economies, the planned economy is more correctly described as one of the sacrificing current consumption and standard of living in order to achieve enhanced future well-being. This is the sacrifice that has to be made by the present generation for the benefit of future generations. It is increasingly difficult to provide examples of truly planned economies. The most obvious cases are North Korea, Cuba, and Eritrea. Until recently, Albania would have been prominent on such a list. However, the market is now having much more of an influence on the economy as the country prepares for entry to European Union.
Okay, good. So you can see that the command economy is central planning, so government deciding on what to do. It's focused more on communism versus capitalism. It's focused on government controlling how you do things, what you produce, how they allocate resources, and so on. Okay, it's all command. Okay, and then we've got one more at the bottom there, which is the mixed economy. Okay, and you'll see the mixed economy is a combination of the top two, and that's the best.
Mm-hmm.
You have to have a bit of both. What I do want you to highlight, though, is the diagram. So in the actual work program, they actually mention that you should look at the diagrams on page 22, page 23, and page 24. So you see that diagram there at the bottom on your left?
Yeah.
And then turn over the page.
Yeah.
No, there's one there, and there's one here. Those ones.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to discuss them in more detail next week when we recap this. Okay, so I'll start with the diagrams and then we'll continue where we left off. But they actually make a specific note here in the work program that you need to refer to those figures. Right, so they might even test you on those diagrams, possibly, because they've actually made an effort to put a note on it in your actual work program. So I do think it's important. All right, the last bit, if you can just read the mixed economy, I'm just going to make some notes. Combination of both command or market and command.
Can we do the mixed economy next week? Because I'm getting like a bit confused and...
just finish reading this paragraph then. Okay, just this last paragraph. Okay, one more.
It is clear from the brief analysis of markets and planned economies that in the pure sense, these types of economic systems occur in theory and not in reality. In contrast, the mixed economy is undoubtedly the characteristic form of economic organization within the global economy. As its name indicates, it involves both private and public sectors in the process of resource allocation. Consequently, decisions on most important economic issues involve some form of planning and interaction between government, business, and labor through the market mechanism. Private ownership of productive resources operates alongside public ownership in many mixed economies, although increasingly the trend is towards the privatization of central activities that were once in public sector hands. The best example of this is undoubtedly the UK economy in the middle 1970s, when the public and private sectors were of broadly equal importance. At this time, the government was responsible for substantial areas of public expenditure, the direct operation of nationalized industries, and providing support for large areas. Over the past 35 years, the strength of the public sector in the UK has been substantially reduced, not only through privatisation and deregulation, but also through a policy of non-invention. When private companies and experience financial difficulties in their markets. Controversially, successive governments have made little or no attempt to stem the demands of car manufacturing in the UK as one by one. Former British-owned companies have been rationalised by their new owners from the rest of from the Europe and USA and Southeast Asia.
Now these are examples, not so important.
Elsewhere there has been similar trends, one of the most dramatic and has been restricted of the economy of the former Soviet Union. Under President reform, small private businesses could be set up in the service sector, and workers could not be their own cooperatives to market and sell surplus production from the state manufacturer's company.
Nice. Last bit at the top and then we're done.
These are over and above the expected provision of external defence and internal security services. It is not easy to explain the importance of a government's role in any particular mixed economy. In most cases, the only real explanation is that it usually is a case of differencing political philosophies. In all cases, except North Korea, countries are moving towards giving the market mechanism an over-increasing role in economic structures. In more recent terms, the experience of a newly industrialized country is interesting. In terms of allocated mechanisms, some such as Singapore and Hong Kong opted for a strong focus on the market to allocate resources and through this have created an economic situation where enterprises can be encouraged and rewarded. Other Southeast Asian tigers have placed more emphasis on central planning while China's phenomenal growth over the past decade has been based on controlled management of the economy within a global context and more recent emphasis on freer markets.
And so you can see that those economies that were very much command economies have changed and have moved more to market economies. Like they mentioned how China and Korea, well, China specifically, that was one that they mentioned in terms of detail, where they've moved more towards, instead of government having as much of a role, trying to open up the economy a bit more to the free markets, which is changing their command economy to a more market economy, which then becomes a more mixed economy. But so mixed is always number one. You want government to have some influence, but you don't want government to have all the influence. At the same time, you can't have a perfect economy where the buyers and sellers dictate what happens. You do need a link or a relationship between the two, and that creates an effective economy. So number C is the best. All countries in the world strive for a more mixed economy where you've got the benefits of both, because there are pros and cons to both the market and the demand. All right, and that's where we'll end today. Well done. Good job. Any specific questions about the content?
No.
You can?
Yeah.
Good. You'll see in the next few lessons, we'll cover some graphs. So you've probably seen graphs like this before, hey? Straight lines, curves. So we'll revisit a little bit of that, but obviously applied in an economic context. All right, but we're doing well. We're on page 24 so far. And in terms of the work program, we're on page 11. Okay, we've just finished the market, the command and the mixed. Okay, so I'm going to ask you just to look at those tasks that they give you here. Okay, so for homework for next week, just look at the work program and just have a look at, like here, complete task 1.3, 1.4, 1.5. Okay, some you said you've done already, so that's great. Just go back and just check that you have looked at all of them, and we can review that next week as well, just to see how you're doing with the theory. Well done. Good job.
Thank you.
Good notes.